Thank you, Pastor Derek. We were going to acknowledge our graduates at this moment, but we're going to wait, Gavin. We're going to do it at the benediction. I can't wait another second to tell you all about Jesus today. And if you haven't already done so, turn to Mark 8. Find yourself there in verse 22. We've got the journals back there if you'd like one to follow along with us. I'm Jeremy, one of the pastors, and I'm a Christian. Because Jesus wanted to. And I just want to extend that invitation to you too, because he might make you a Christian today. And for those who are Christians, he may encourage you. And that's my hope. So Jesus and his disciples, they crossed this Sea of Galilee after he fed 4,000 people with a little bit of bread and a little bit of fish. And then he, before that, he healed a deaf and a mute man. They make their way. After this, he gets in a boat and makes his way across the Sea of Galilee, and they come to Bethsaida. And that's where we have our time in our text this morning. We'll pick up in verse 22. And they came to Bethsaida, the hometown of Peter and Andrew, as well as Philip, three disciples of the 12. It's their hometown. And some people brought to Jesus a blind man and begged him to touch him. Now imagine being this blind man, how difficult his life must have been. Very challenging to be blind, I'm sure. I cannot imagine how difficult, let alone before Braille, before animals could help assist, like dogs, before all these sorts of more modern aids to assist someone like this. Very challenging in first century life. And he was totally blind. There was no deception about his blindness. It wasn't a trick for Jesus. This man pretending to be blind and just for Jesus to leverage a fake healing. This man was blind. He could not see a ray of light. He knew nothing about light or shapes. He could not see anything. Now think about this with me. This man had never seen anything that Jesus had done. He had to believe the testimony of other people, right? So off the bat, that tells us that others told this man about Jesus and that it was worth making their way to meet Jesus because there's a chance that he could be helped. Please always be aware of the ability and opportunity that you have to tell other people how wonderful Jesus is to you personally. Never underestimate the power of your story of how God has changed and shaped your life and sharing that hope with others. We see how much of an impact it had on this fellow in our text and in your friends, your family, your coworkers, your neighbors. They could be learning an awful lot about Jesus. If you would like this fellow's friends, tell them about Jesus. Well, Jesus, verse 23, took the blind man by the hand and led him out of the village. And when he had spit on his eyes and laid his hands on him, he asked him, "Do you see anything?" Several friends brought this blind man to Jesus, right? And their faith in Jesus, as well as this man's faith, it's going to be rewarded, and we'll see here. You see, Jesus responds to faith. Jesus hears the desperate cry for help to all who call out for mercy and help. Jesus will never ignore. He'll never turn a deaf ear to you. He's never done it before. And I promise you won't be the first one that he ignores when you ask for help. Jesus leads this blind man away from the noise of the crowd, out of the confusion of the village. I don't know why, but perhaps because he wanted to make sure this man heard Jesus clearly without any distractions. And then Jesus does two things. He spits on the guy's eyes. That's weird. That's strange. I've studied it. It doesn't make sense. But he spits in his face, spits in his eyes. It worked, as we know, but still strange. And the second is he places his hands on the blind man. But if you think about it, these are both things that a blind man can feel. You see, Jesus, he wanted this man to experience this moment, to participate in this moment, and not just have it changed, but to experience the change, to feel the change. He wanted him to experience him. And he looked up and he says, the blind man looks up and he says, I see people, but they look like trees walking. I see shadows, I see silhouettes, but nothing is clear. It's blurry. I'll take it. I'll take it. It's much better. It's not what it was. I'm good, honestly. But then Jesus laid his hands on his eyes again, and he opened his eyes, and his sight was restored, and he saw everything clearly. And he said to him, and he sent him to his home, saying, do not even enter the village. Now, I'm not sure why this healing took two stages or two parts. Perhaps it was the skepticism of the man's faith. I'm not really sure. Mark doesn't tell us. The author doesn't tell us. But what's wonderful is that Jesus, he didn't leave the man half healed. He stayed with the man until he saw everything clearly. And then the man is warned by Jesus to go straight home without going back to the village. Maybe it was because he would be seen and more people would be tempted to follow Jesus as healer and not savior. And we're at risk of the same thing. We know for sure that Jesus did not want to build an earthly kingdom. He continued to push back against this. He did not want his kingdom to be built merely on his supernatural power and authority. So he tells this man to not tell anyone. And I find two things ironic here is this man who had healing faith in Jesus to some degree. The first thing he does is he disobeys Jesus. And Jesus knew he was going to do it, and he healed him anyway. That's Jesus. What's also ironic is Jesus tells him not to go, and he goes, and he shares with everybody. What's also ironic, though, is he clearly tells us to go. And so often, we stay, and we're quiet. You know, in this passage, we see Jesus, and he comes and he mercifully helps heal a blind man. Jesus, the one who was in the very beginning, the creator of all things, present with our triune God, there in the beginning, he's doing what he's done all along. And he's recreating, he's creating, he's reforming, he's healing people, those who become his people. He's restoring things. He's redeeming things. He's reinstituting the beauty of creation that sin had marred and destroyed and corrupted. He's setting things right. He's putting things back to the way that they should be. What Jesus does is not what Jesus is doing, he's setting things back to normal. He's not doing something odd or peculiar when he heals somebody of their blindness. He's getting rid of what is odd and peculiar, and he's making things normal again. He's bringing things back the way they should be, as in the original normal, before the effects of the fall. This is the Messiah. It's how he works. It's what he does. It is his ministry. It is his joy. It is his task. This is the God-man, Jesus Christ. This is why he came. And he wants to recreate in you as well. Psalm 51, we referenced it earlier. David said, create in me a clean heart. That word create is the same word used in Genesis 1. Hebrew, bara ex nihilo, to create from nothing. Will you create from nothing a heart here? That's what he wants to do in you. He wants to recreate. He wants to reform. He wants to heal. He wants to be more than your homeboy and friend. He wants to be your Lord, Savior, and rescuer. You see, the blind character in the text this morning, he's a picture of us without Jesus. He's a picture of you. And you know, not only is our world and our bodies and our minds corrupted by sin, but more significantly, our sin has separated us eternally from the God we were created to know personally and be in relationship with, like a real relationship. More intimate than your most intimate friendship, more real than your realest relationship. You were created and fashioned for that, and sin just destroyed it, causing a separation between us and God. And so in a spiritual sense, all people are born blind. It's original sin, inherited from our first parents, Adam and Eve. We're sinners by birth through Adam and Eve, and by choice through Jeremy, through you. We all suffer from this. We're born blind to the things of God, and Scripture even tells us that we're dead to God. But the mission of the Messiah, the mission of Jesus, God in the flesh, his mission wasn't merely to demonstrate his power over sickness and death, but his mission was to die himself. But not just to die for a specific purpose. To die as your substitute. To suffer God's wrath in your place, taking on full responsibility for your horrible actions and the horrible actions done against you. He died for that in your place, becoming the curse that you deserve to absorb on yourself, he takes upon him. And then 3 days later, he beats death through his resurrection, defeating and demolishing the power of death, which is the curse. And the result is that by faith in Jesus Christ and his work, we are healed of our sin disease, of our illness eternally. We're forgiven, we're saved, eternally cured, eternally rescued, and made whole, everything eternally restored. Being saved is placing your hope in this. It's trusting in the efficiency and the sufficiency of Jesus Christ, that he can save you, that he will save you, and that he has saved you. I mean, essentially, the gospel of Jesus Christ is summarized in verse 25. Then Jesus laid his hands on his eyes, he opened his eyes, his sight was restored, and he saw everything clearly. That is what you're looking for. That is what we're looking for. We're blind and we're looking for help anywhere, everywhere. That's why we're so dysfunctional. That's why we're such addicts. That's why we try clicking on everything we possibly can, running anywhere we possibly can, numbing everything we possibly can, because something's not right. We can't see things. We can't see things clearly. And what we need is Jesus. He's got to come to us. He's got to touch us. He's got to open our eyes. He's got to restore our sight to us. And then we will be able to see everything clearly, because Jesus changes everything. But you know, you can sit in a room like this week after week and you can hear about Jesus and never be healed. Never experience him. You can learn, you can study, you can know all the right answers, you can win all the theological arguments and never have your heart and your eyes changed by grace. There must be a response from you out of faith and trust and confidence in Christ. Has Jesus touched your heart? Have you extended your hand to him, even through your insecurities, through your hurt, through your fear? Have you asked Jesus to give you faith to believe him and just take him at his word? Or have you made things so complex, adding layers that Jesus never did? When's the last time that you were like this blind man and you simply made your way to Jesus and you go to his feet in raw need, humility, and desperation, and you just ask him to help you? Have you ever reached out to Jesus in faith? But the result of faith in Jesus is you're saved, you're changed, you're made whole, and I want you to experience the risen Lord Jesus personally, not theologically, not corporately in a group, getting goosebumps as we sing songs, not theoretically, not intellectually. I want you to experience Jesus personally. I want you to experience Jesus and a relationship with his Father. I want you to walk every day for the rest of your life in renewal and restoration and forgiveness, not shouldering shame or guilt or fear anymore. So that when you face dark days of oppression, when you find yourself in the middle of confusion and depression, you do so knowing that God is with you and that he'll never leave you and that he's for you. I'd love for you to experience Jesus in such a way that you want to tell other people about Jesus. I mean, remember the blind man, he'd never seen Jesus do anything before. He had to believe the story of other people. He had to hear it from somebody else, their testimony. Friend, there's people that you work with in your city who work with you, live on your street, they're in your families, and they're blind. They can't see Jesus for who he really is. And it makes life so much more difficult. And they're trying their best. And you've got the help. And you're not telling them about the help. I mean, they might only get Jesus from what they learn from you, from what you speak to them, like this blind man did. Does your testimony inform others about Jesus? Through your words, through your way of life, can other people learn of Jesus? I mean, the power of your testimony and your story is amazing. It's remarkable. With your life, with your words, lead people to Jesus, tenderly to Jesus, because they're blind, remember. Don't run too fast. Walk them tenderly to Jesus with your life and with your words. There's people in our city who are exhausted and they're trying everything. They're trying to find fulfillment. They're trying to find satisfaction. And they're looking for soul rest everywhere, anywhere. They're trying anything. And most are doing so apart from Jesus. Do you believe that there's something about Jesus that they need? Do you believe that Jesus can make a difference in other people's lives? Have you ever experienced Jesus in a way that you were truly changed, that you were made different? If so, that's what they're looking for. And if not, that's what I want you to see. I want you to experience that. Would you pray with me today, asking God to help us believe him more and to help us speak to others more about him and share more about his son, Jesus? Speaking to others more than we do, not with a bold and brash swagger and attitude, yet with a boldness and courage that's laced with grace and a kind tone that's winsome, like Jesus. Share more and more about Jesus. Speak of the hope that you've found in him, the redeeming work of Christ in your life personally. Just tell them about that. But I know that we're so often busy. We're preoccupied. And it's tough to talk much about Jesus with our friends and our neighbors and our coworkers. Would you pray with me today, maybe even right now, regarding how often we're so preoccupied with other things that simply can't compare to getting people to Jesus? Yeah, I know for some, it's not that you're preoccupied. It's just that what you're going through right now has you in a tailspin. And helping others seems down the way a little bit. But right now, it's you who needs help. Man, I understand. Would you come to Jesus? Would you ask Jesus to help you see? Would you ask him to simply help you? Here's how you do it. God, help me. I've prayed that so much lately. That's all I got. That's all I need. That's all you need. Maybe your struggle and your circumstance has you in a place where you're unsure of a lot of stuff. Will you simply call out to Jesus and ask him for help? He will help you. You know, this man, he probably begged for a lot of things in his life. I doubt he ever begged to see. On the side of the road, begging for money, begging for clothes, begging for food. I doubt he was like, please help me see. Open my eyes for me. No. Jesus doesn't give him money. He doesn't give him clothes. He doesn't give him food. Jesus gave this man what he thought was impossible. He let him see. Friend, what is it that you need to ask of Jesus that you haven't because you think there's no chance? Don't tell the blind man that. Or maybe you don't think he's interested in your need because it's not spiritual. My friend, Jesus is interested in everything about you. Everything. Everything is spiritual. All of life. Every detail. And Jesus is concerned with every detail. There is no false dichotomy of practical and spiritual. Jesus sees it all the same. God is interested in every detail of your life. And those who aren't Christians yet, who don't believe Jesus yet, I'm asking that the Holy Spirit of God reveals to you your blindness and you stumble your way towards Jesus. I'm asking that you, right now, ask God to reveal to you your blindness. You need Jesus. He is what your life needs. He is what is missing. Jesus is the keystone relationship that will set in motion stability and peace in your life that'll trickle down to every part of who you are and every part of your world. Much like when Jesus walked up to this blind man, today, understand that Jesus is looking upon you this moment. He is standing in front of you. Though you might not see him, he sees you. His shadow is falling on you. And he's considering your case. And he knows of your situation. He understands your fears and your struggles, your anxiety and your depression. He's aware of your doubts, your skepticism, and your unbelief. He's aware of the struggle. He's so aware of your depression and fears, your dark thoughts, and he's so not afraid. He's not shocked. He's not disappointed. That's why he came. Remember what he said in Mark chapter 2? Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners. Sick and needy people. That's why I'm here. Your desperate situation is precisely why Jesus came 2,000 years ago. It's exactly why God pulled you into this room today. Are you praying? Are you asking for help? He's listening. Oh, he's listening. And he's paying attention to you. Oh, he's thinking of you. There's nothing more interesting to Jesus than you. I mean, at this moment, Jesus is able to say the word that'll take the film from your eyes and let everlasting light of grace into every part of who you are. Do you believe this? If so, then cry out, Lord, help me receive my sight. My friend, he will hear you. Just simply say, God, help me. I mean, perhaps even now, God will send the light of God into your darkened heart, and then to your delight, you'll find yourself in a new world, escaping darkness, entering into his marvelous light. And also know that the great change that you need in order to be saved is beyond your ability and power. You can't do this to yourself. You can't affect it yourself. You can't make this change come about, or Jesus would not have showed up. But he showed up because you can't. May the Lord do this new thing in you in this moment and bring you into a new reality that's founded on Jesus Christ and his righteousness. And you understand what it means to be a new creation through the Spirit of God saving you, changing you, making you born again, making you alive, giving you hope and peace as you experience grace and kindness and mercy and the love of God. And how that works to re-identify you. Not of what people have said of you. Not of your to-do list abilities. Not of what the mirror says or your bank account or how many gigs you have coming up on a tour or what role you're going to play in the next film or the next pay increase or promotion. You're not defined by these things. Jesus showed up to change the subject entirely and to re-identify you as beloved, chosen, enough, mine, the apple of my eye, the center of my heart, my bride. He's come to re-identify you because of and through Jesus. Friend, this is what we need. Jesus needs to lay his hands on our eyes. He needs to open our eyes. He needs to restore our sight so that we can see things clearly. May God do this in our hearts, and may he continue to do it day by day until we see him in paradise, when we will see him clearly, not through a mirror, darkly and dimly, but face to face. And in that moment, you will not regret one second that you lived your life surrendered to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. And you will not regret one word that you spoke about Christ to your friends. Nor will you regret one ounce of suffering that you had to endure through this sucky, sinful life that we have. Because he works out all things for the good. Even what you and I are going through. Because he's good. Let's remember the source of this hope, the source of this healing, together this morning through communion. That source is none other than Jesus Christ and him crucified and risen and returning. We offer to you bread and juice and wine, symbols that Christ gave us, pictures of a greater reality, the body, flesh of Jesus Christ and his life represented by the bread, his atoning substitutionary death in our place represented by the red liquid symbolic of the blood of Christ that atones, that covers, that cleanses us from sin. So as you come and take this morning, remind yourself of your true healing, of the escape from blindness, of the escape from judgment, of the rescue back into a relationship with God that you do not deserve. And this is not your fault. It's the gift of God that he's given to you and placed in your heart. And so we remember this now. We're going to have servers on each side of the stage. We're going to have self-serve stations in the back. You're going to take the bread, dip it into the juice or the wine, and you do what Jesus said. You remember. You remember. Let's pray. Father, I ask that you add your special blessing to this time of remembering. Lord, that you take these truths and plant them deep in the hearts of your people. And that you take those who are not your people that are in this room, that are listening, and you make them your people, I pray. Remove the scales from their eyes. Remove the film from their eyes. Remove the blindness from their situation and allow them to see in the name of Jesus Christ. Allow them to see. And now these are the gifts of God for the people of God. And we proclaim the mystery of faith that Christ has lived, he's died, Christ is risen, and Christ will surely come again. Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Now may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be on this time of communion, this time of remembering, this time of worshiping. And may our triune God remain with us always, even through the end of the age. Amen. Christian, when you're ready, you're welcome to come to the Lord's table this morning. You can come when you're ready.